Welcome back, everyone. I don't have to introduce Jennifer Ponce-Leon because she came in earlier for the discussion that we had with Soloa Lusta Rubina. So I think we'll dive right in and get started with things. What we thought that we would do with this particular session is that it's related to a collective project that we've both been working on for about a year at this point. And we wanted to at once kind of sketch out some of the stakes of the project, but then also talk through the kind of collaborative process of sorting through the kind of various dimensions of it, and also then want to relate it to some specifics by sharing with you an excerpt from the film that everybody watched, and just commenting on some of the formal aspects and how that relates to the kind of larger theoretical argument. And we've really conceived of this as a dialogue, so we'll kind of be jumping back and forth, and obviously anyone's welcome to jump in at any point in time. I thought that I would start just by highlighting that what we're interested in many ways is an object of analysis that is only perceptible as a kind of anamorphotic point within the current matrix of the disciplines and the way in which they train our gazes to see certain things and to ignore or not see or other things. An anamorphotic point, of course, is a point of perception that actually changes the entire horizons of what it is that you see and allows an alternative object to emerge. Right? So the very process of anamorphosis is one by which the visual field, all of a sudden from one specific vantage point, reveals something that was invisible within the visual field prior to the alignment on that point. One of the reasons that this is important, and this is the kind of methodological background for some of the concerns in this project, is that we realize that Jennifer and I actually work on very different cultural territories. We're trained, I think, respectively in three or four different disciplines, none of which are the same. And so there's really no visible disciplinary or cultural overlap between what it is that we work on. But at the same time, we realize through conversations that actually behind all of this disciplinary framing and cultural framing, the fundamental themes and issues are the same. They are just formulated in very, very different ways, and they're difficult to formulate within the extant disciplines. And so just to say a little bit more about this, it's that the major displacement, because we'll be moving a lot between the kind of visible and the invisible, or a visible field and then an anamorphotic point that will take us into another field that was invisible from the field within which we were, I think one of the central preoccupations is that the way people understand art in the contemporary socio-historical conjuncture is in terms of a certain refined type of cultural production, usually by a creative genius or an assortment of creative geniuses, that is then presented within a kind of exhibitionary framework. And so if you say art or you say aesthetics, it evokes things like people creating beautiful objects for other people to consume with their gaze. One way of understanding, and I'll just leave it at this to start with, the shift that we're interested in is an understanding of aesthetics that radically breaks with this apprehension of art and renders it as a cultural, historical, and socially specific understanding of a much broader phenomenon that it actually forecloses, that it actually renders invisible. And that is aesthetics, in a broader sense, understood as the way a collectivity forges the entire sensorium of its experience, meaning the way in which it produces a world of visible, audible, understandable, exchangeable, communicable objects, things, and experiences. And it is very expansive notion of aesthetics, which is how a people creates its universe, is largely collapsed within the current disciplinary framework and the ways in which we're intellectually trained, so that we only focus on rarefied objects of art, and we usually do it in such a way that this broader question of the sensorium is either foreclosed or sidelined. And what you have then is a reduction of aesthetics in this broad kind of Greek sense of the term aistheton, which is simply the sensory, the sensible, to a very rarefied consumerist conception of a work of art or works of art that function in a particular way within a display mechanism and within market mechanisms. So I'll turn it over to you to kind of bleed into some of the thoughts that you want to share.
Yeah. Well, I want to, just to pick up on that, because I think one of this idea of the reduction of the idea of what aesthetics inhabits is also because largely the power of aesthetics are taken over, channeled by the ruling class, right? We see this in the culture industry, we see this in nationalist uses of aesthetics, in the institutionalization of all different forms of cultural production, right? Which is, often makes, it's ironic then that those same powers then feed back to us the idea that culture doesn't matter, that that it only, inhabits these sort of minor spaces within the world, when actually what actually happens is that it is instrumentalized almost completely, right? So I think what I wanted to pick up on, and this is something that has, a question that has driven a lot of my own research, and it's, I think, a really central question in the Solanas and Gitino text that you read, is this kind of, the fundamental question is, what is the place of intellectuals, of cultural producers, of artists, thinking of these all together in, what is their role, or our role, in anti-systemic movements? In class struggle, in revolutionary struggle. That is the question I think Solanas and Gitino are posing ultimately in their essay that you read and what they're trying to address in the film that you saw. And I just wanted to situate this within, since this is kind of a fundamental question within the larger tradition of Marxist aesthetic thought and practice. It's very famously theorized in the 1930s by people like Brecht and Benjamin, writing in the context of the Communist International. And so I want to just lay out kind of how that, thinking of this question in the way that Solanas and Gitino are talking about it, and the way that people like Brecht and Benjamin, also Augusto Boal, have talked about this, of these other kind of theorists and practitioners of Marxist aesthetic theory and art making, how they reframe the question of cultural production. And again, I just want to emphasize that even we're talking about art, but by that I also mean the work of intellectuals and other all different kinds of writers and cultural producers. So when they're, the way that in the 1930s, as I mentioned, Brecht and Benjamin are writing about this, they reframe the question of the politics of art in two really important ways. And they're countering, on one hand, this kind of long-standing approach to thinking about socialist art that's associated with the notion of tendency, which basically has to do with cultural producers taking up a correct political line and representing a certain kind of political line in their what they produce. But the problem with this is that a specifically socialist or communist politics of authorship doesn't emerge necessarily from just a particular content or prescribed form. And this is part of one of the big things that's kind of at stake in debates at this time, is if a kind of socialist art can be formally codified. But what the way that they reframe this question is by saying that, first of all, that the place of the intellectual in class struggle can only be chosen on the basis of her position in the process of production of culture, right? And this is important because it's reframing the idea of kind of the activist intellectual away from thinking about intellectuals as being necessarily kind of a vanguard of class struggle by saying, to think of intellectuals as a collectivity, of course, is lacking in class analysis. Intellectuals come from all different kinds of classes, oftentimes are kind of organic to the ruling class. So we can't think of intellectuals as a kind of political collectivity in and of themselves, but rather have to reflect on the position that an intellectual occupies in class struggle, and then from there understand what her politics would be in relationship to that struggle, right? And the second, I think, part of reframing this question, this is where we really get to one of the things that Solanas and Gitino are talking about, is saying that, therefore, the kind of we can't just judge the politics of a cultural producer's work based on kind of the content that it represents, but also based on how she transforms the apparatus of cultural production through her work on it. And this is, so, and part of this is this kind of demand that progressive intelligentsia that's interested in the liberation of the means of production, of cultural production and intellectual production, can't just simply transmit the apparatus of cultural production as it exists, but has to change it to the maximum extent possible in the direction of socialism. And if we think about this, I mean, it makes sense if we think of that generally the means of intellectual production, the means of cultural production are owned, you know, by the ruling class, right? So, you know, for Solana Sangentino thinking about this, they talk about this in terms of thinking of cinema. They say, you know, cinema is, it basically serves the ideological and economic interests of a global elite. Many of the owners are in the U.S. So we can't, we have to rethink entirely that apparatus, right? Because the apparatus that exists is owned by our political and class enemies. So one of the things that I think that comes from this, when it's theorized, again, I'm thinking of Brecht and Benjamin in the 30s, is saying that, well, then what if what intellectuals need to do is transform the apparatus of cultural production. One of the ways that they should do this is to aim to socialize the instruments of cultural production, leading consumers to become producers, making co-workers out of spectators. And Brecht, when he's writing about this in the 30s, is really emphasizing the urgency of this given the increasing concentration of ownership of means of communication and increasing specialization. He's writing about radio in particular, right? Solana Sangentino are talking about how important this is with cinema, as they understand cinema to be the most powerful communications technology in the context they're writing. So given that, there's this, you know, question of, well, how do we socialize this, so it's socialize this apparatus of production, right? And one of the ways I think we see this, these are basically the very similar questions that Solana Sangentino are taking up. At the same time, their contemporary Augusto Boal is doing this in terms of rethinking of theater, how you can socialize the means of theatrical production to make theater into kind of rehearsal for revolution. I just want to highlight a few ways that they do this. We can see it both from what you saw of our of the Furnaces of the first part, but then also their text on Third Cinema. Because it's basically, you know, facing this situation that the means of cinematic production are owned by political and class enemies, they say, you know, how do we totally then rethink the entire apparatus of cinematic production, which means rethinking its production, its distribution, and its reception, right? And this is something we've talked a lot about in our research, and Gabriel's written on extensively, is that the cultural politics of any kind of artistic practice has to be understood across all of these domains of production, circulation, and reception. It can't just be analyzed in the context of just a form or just a kind of a content, right? So some of the ways I think that they're doing this that in rethinking what cinema could be, right? On one hand, they're writing against cinema that's just a kind of form of entertainment, right? And we know this kind of to be a common critique of cultural, you know, mass cultural production made by the ruling class as a form of sort of ideological pacification. But they're also arguing, and I think this is an important, against work that only represents, like, the effects of social problems and doesn't address the causes. And I think this reminds me of, I think there's a really smart thing that Freire talks about, and again, he's a contemporary, and talks about kind of that providing only localized, kind of a local apprehension of what is wrong with the world, without actually giving people a kind of context to understand the causes of that, is itself a form of ideological oppression.
Could I jump in just on that? Because it overlaps with some of the conversations that we've had, particularly in the last session. One of the things that I think is a concern is that when you focus, just as you say, on the effects or the consequences, for instance, of something like neoliberal capitalism, and you look at modes of subjectivation without actually giving an account of how those modes of subjectivation are produced historically and materially, you can run into precisely this problem. Insofar as then neoliberalism becomes this kind of mythological bogeyman that out of nowhere has produced different types of subjectivity, but the process of that production is obfuscated, as well as the lines of friends and enemies, because then everybody just becomes a subject of neoliberal capitalism, but you don't have a way of identifying those who are actually responsible agents in its perpetuation, and those who are simply the passive recipients of it.
Yeah.
And so I think that it overlaps with some of the earlier conversations, but I didn't mean to cut you
off. Yeah, no, I think that's, because that's something, you know, we've been talking a lot about as a kind of common form of cultural representation about neoliberalism tends to, there is a kind of one tendency of it tends to be a description of the kind of subjectivities that it is understood to produce without understanding the kind of political, economic, and military forms of domination that are underneath these, right, that produce these.
Yeah, and so at best what you have is a description of the kind of biopolitical mechanisms, but you defang the possibility of having one of the subjects of capitalism be the revolutionary, or the militant, or the person labeled as a terrorist, or things like that. And it would seem that if you had accounts of subjectivity like that, well, you would break quite significantly with, and I'm not saying that everybody who works on biopolitics does this, of course. I'm just saying that there's one thread that I find to be leading down quite a dangerous path, and it overlaps precisely with this problem.
I'll just talk a bit more about this, and then I'll give it to you.
Aesthetics.
Now, so the few of the, just going back to this, you know, the question of how do you really, how do you rethink what cinema could be, right? If you have to entirely rethink of this as this kind of apparatus of cultural production. So, again, so this is this idea of something that can provide a kind of systemic analysis, is one of the things that they write about. But they're also, you know, really rethinking what cinema as a kind of thinking of it as being as a tool of analysis, a tool of consciousness raising, and as a catalyst for political action. Understanding, you know, that there is, so they're basically trying to rethink of what cinema can be as a tool of political organizing. And this is something that is, we see this across, there's kind of, there's myriad examples of politicized cultural production that has, you know, aimed to do this, whether it's with theater, you think of something like, obviously, Brecht's theater, or Boal's theater, Teatro Campesino, or obviously literary production, intellectual production that is doing this, right? So they're also thinking, and I think one of the things important is they're saying, you know, it's possible at the time, and I'm going to just talk about this a bit later, but that they also think it's possible to think of a revolutionary cinema because of the conjuncture within which they're operating, which is one where socialist and anti-imperialist revolution had been achieved in places and was very much on the horizon in other places. So they're saying, you know, conjuncturally, this demands a revolutionary filmmaking practice. But they're also, so thinking about, you know, the production, distribution, and reception, this film is largely produced clandestinely with input from different workers' organizations and militants. It changes over the course of its production because of input from people who are, you know, who are participating in this production. It also is rethinking the kind of what a screening would be, right? So that they talk about how each kind of showing becomes something like an enlarged cell meeting. So understanding that the film offers a pretext for gathering people together, and that can be a kind of pretext for a political meeting, an aspect of a political meeting. and finally, and this is very much part of the kind of, you know, Brechtian heritage that I was talking about, is this that it's a film that does not want passive consumers or passive spectators. It wants co-conspirators, and that's how it is interpolating you. That it is, it basically continually short-circuits kind of spectatorial passivity, and it makes intellectual demands of its spectator. So you can think of the film as a kind of a way of learning. It has a kind of open-endedness to it. And rather than putting a hero on a screen with which, you know, a spectator would be asked to identify, it addresses, directly addresses the you as a spectator, often operating through kind of I-you discourse, and it is continually suggesting that the viewer is an agent of history, and hailing you in that way, right? I'll go ahead and close for now.
Yeah, I just want to pick up on a few of the threads. One is the conceptual framing of a particular understanding of art and its relationship to the social world, that one of the things that we're kind of both pushing back against is what I've referred to as the social epoche, that you could understand art while bracketing the broader social world in which it exists. And usually that epoche functions in two ways. One is that you bracket out production, and all that you focus on is the individual producer. And the artist then would have good, bad, or mediocre politics, and somehow they would just express this in the work of art, and so the politics of art would be a matter of mining into the good, bad, or mediocre politics of the producer. Outside of, usually, the entire field and mode of production, which includes not only economic factors, but technological factors, institutional elements, etc. And then the other way in which you see this very clearly in a lot of the theoretical debates on art and politics is in terms of the product. So that art is understood as this rarefied object that is produced once and for all and just given over to the masses or to the institutions that share it with the masses. And the product then is understood as if it had a politics unto itself, which is actually, when you kind of think through it, nonsensical, at least for the majority of modes of artistic production. That is that an object, say, again, a painting, a novel, or something along these lines, would only have some type of political impact insofar as it's inserted within social communities that act on, produce, mobilize certain forces within it, etc. And so what the social epoche ends up doing is it ultimately severs works of art from its social matrix and hence ultimately from any robust materialist understanding of what politics could be. It produces what I've referred to as a talisman complex. The talisman complex is the assumption that you could have these privileged, beautiful little objects produced by these privileged, beautiful little souls that would miraculously produce some type of political consequences that can only be understood by the grand philosophical interpreter who can, through different modes of enchantment, allow the spirit of the object to percolate to the top and then be visible, because it certainly isn't visible in the object itself. So in other words, this we're both kind of pushing back against this social epoche of both the producer and the product of art in the name of a much broader understanding of the social politicity of aesthetic practices. Meaning understanding aesthetic practices as being quintessentially social and being embedded at their level of the production, circulation, and reception within social networks, hence being always already sites of political struggle. And so this is kind of giving the philosophical underside to a lot of the things that Jennifer has just said, because in many ways what this film is doing is it's aware, obviously, of all of these things, and it's trying to produce a film that takes all of this into account, but then takes it into account in such a way that it's not just a conceptual endeavor, but it changes the very way in which you produce art, because you're not producing an object to be consumed once and for all as within the kind of framework of exhibition. Instead, you're trying to transform a broader social world. Mm-hmm. And one of the other things that I wanted to bring into the conversation in this regard, and this is also a kind of broader philosophic claim, and that is an understanding of aesthetics coming out of this that is much broader and capacious than this restricted, rarefied conception of art with its, you know, individual producers and consumers. And that is an understanding of aesthetics that breaks with, and forgive me in advance, but there'll be a little bit of philosophical or metaphysical intervention at this moment, that breaks with the presumption that art can be understood within the great ontological divide that has haunted a lot of the Western and non-Western traditions, for that matter. And that is a division between human beings and the world. What traditionally is called man and world, or mind and body, or material world, or the intellect and the material. Of course, there are a million different iterations of this. And usually, art or aesthetics is understood as somehow an interface between the two. That it is a way of representing something that might be real, but representing it for feelings, for the mind, or something along these lines. Against that, philosophically, and here I'd be more than happy to discuss it in detail, but we're picking up not only on the lineage of Brecht and Benjamin, but digging deeper into that history, the work of people like Schiller, the early Marx, Whitman, and others that one could identify with this lineage, are actually trying to at once conceptualize and artistically act upon an understanding of aesthetics that breaks down the ontological great divide. In other words, aesthetics is not a way of representing or rendering the world that might be beautiful or might be ugly or might be politically trenchant or not. Aesthetics is understood not in terms of a binary ontology, but in terms of an ontology in which the world is made through the production of a sensorium. And the sensorium is the totality of the world. So it's not that art represents something or that there's a real world that is interpreted by an aesthetic matrix, but instead that there's a shared sensorium, meaning a shared experience of sensory reality that produces what is most fundamentally real. In that sense, then, aesthetics would be understood in this kind of broad Greek sense of the term of it's the composition of a world. It's the composition of a shared sensorium. And what it does, this aesthetics in the broad sense, is it makes sense. But it does it in both senses of this expression. It produces a world that makes sense because it resonates with the sensory apparatus of all of those who are part of the world. But it also makes sense conceptually. And so the other thing that this more expansive notion of aesthetics is doing is it's breaking down the division between sensory knowledge and conceptual knowledge. And the idea of making sense operates at both of these levels. It's an attempt to dissolve the distinction between perception or sensory knowledge and conceptual knowledge, which is, of course, a very, very long-standing and developed distinction. In other words, aesthetics is not a map of or a representation of the world. It's the shared production of a sensorium. Now, one of the reasons that that is important is that, and this has, I think, an important political set of implications, is that the world as we apprehend it is always already framed, produced, manufactured aesthetically. It's not that there's the real world and then a representation of it, but the real world is aesthetically manufactured. In this sense, then, what we see, and here I'm thinking of the early Marx, the 1844 manuscripts, when he basically says that we never see the world with our own eyes, which is such a profound statement and so true. We never see the world with our own eyes because the way in which we apprehend, even at a base phenomenological level, the world is through a shared aesthetic apparatus that already frames that world as one that makes sense to us as cultural beings. We see racialized subjects, we see gendered subjects, we see class subjects. The reason for all of this phenomenological experience is not because there's a kind of zero point of subjectivity that apprehends the given world. On the contrary, it's because we're all always already aesthetic subjects formatted by particular cultures to perceive the world in specific ways. So in this sense, one of the things that we're interested in coming out of this kind of Schiller, Marx, you could put Rancière, a certain Rancière in there, this heritage and trying to at once think through it and push it forward is an understanding of aesthetic revolution as an inversion of the given constituted aesthetic matrix. An aesthetic revolution occurs when the apparent world, the world that everybody sees and shares as the given world, all of a sudden reveals itself to be the opposite of what we, at a base experiential level, presumed it to be. And this is why I think it's important for the work that we've been doing that it's related to certain debates on ideology, but it's by no means an understanding of ideology as just a representational set of false beliefs about the real world. Instead, it's drawing on, in Marx and Engels' German ideology, a materialist conception of ideology in which they describe the core functioning of ideology in terms of a camera obscura. A camera obscura that literally turns the world upside down, but does not tell us it's turned the world upside down. So the camera obscura of ideology is not just an aesthetic inversion in this more traditional sense of the term, that there's a real world and it's represented upside down. It actually produces a world in which our most base experience is one in which the relations of power, for instance, are inverted. there's a million good examples of this, right? That wage labor is something that is beneficial for the laborer, when, of course, it's actually just a form of slavery and extraction of value, right? That's an upside-down world, when you're happy to have a job because your oppressor has given you one, as opposed to understanding how it actually works. So in this sense, some of the kind of philosophic work that we're drawing on is trying to understand aesthetics in this broader sense, identifying this camera obscura, which is, of course, a quintessentially aesthetic depiction of how ideology functions, and then indexing an aesthetic revolution as that which would be the opposite of the camera obscura of ideology. An aesthetic revolution is that which would break with the naturalized given understanding of the world and reveal that that understanding of the world is the result of an aesthetic production. And so I might just leave it at that, because I think that there's aesthetic revolutions, we've been talking a lot about this, can occur at different levels. They vary depending on reception. There's nothing given about them in the sense that you can't just point to one example and say that this is what an aesthetic revolution is for all time. But I do think that there are different instances that can be highlighted, and the excerpt that I want to show from the film, I think, gives a great microscopic account of what that would quite literally look like and sound like. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and before we get, there's two things I want to cover, I think. One is just to emphasize this idea of, I think, I don't know if you used the term, but of the kind of that intellectuals and cultural producers are always already instrumentalized generally within the one way to think about it is that, you know, the social role of intellectuals and cultural producers is to produce a kind of self-evident relationship between the state and civil society, or to prepare the kind of subjects to be incorporated into a state hegemony. And that's what the typical role of intellectuals is, I think, we'd also say with a lot of cultural production, it's also to produce, profit for cultural industries. But it's I just want to emphasize that, because that is so often forgotten in debates about political art, that presume that there can be an art that is not already caught up in the politics, right? And that the only kind of art that is political art is when, it's pamphletary, it's propagandistic, and we see it. And most often, the kind of political work that culture does is the work that it does to naturalize the bourgeois values and the given social order, so its politics are rendered invisible, right? And this is just, this is something that I think both of us have dealt with, pushed up a lot against in kind of our dedication to thinking about art that would be useful for anti-systemic politics. It's something that in the essay that we read, they very directly address, and saying that oftentimes there's this kind of false division in the idea of what a politicized intellectual work would be, and that usually there's an idea that it has to be like writing manifestos or just strategizing, for kind of military strategy or something like this, but that this is based on oftentimes, on one hand, kind of idea, again, that you can have a kind of autonomous intellectual work. And they remind us, of all the forms of knowledge production that are always tied up with class politics, which is very obvious when we think of things like psychology and medicine and urban planning and things like this, engineering, etc. It's just as true with all different forms of cultural production, right? But then they make, I think, a very good point that oftentimes what we see, what happens with culture, is that ruling class culture passes itself off as universal culture, therefore obfuscating its political interests, right? And this is something I think is particularly important. I'm sure we've all encountered this. It's also a particularly important thing in the context in which the film was produced. At the time, part of the U.S. State Department through the CIA and its other involved organizations was very active in promoting and funding culture in Latin America at this time. That was under the aegis of kind of promoting a universal culture, against the emergent revolutionary nationalisms that were that did exist in Latin America. But what I think it's what's interesting about it is the the strategy, the essentially counterinsurgent, counter-revolutionary strategy in culture was this kind of promotion of a universalist culture as the gold standard of the highest kind of culture that could be produced. And that was behind funding literary magazines, etc. I think it just, before we do your post reading, I wanted to just talk a little bit about the context in which the Solanas and Gentile are writing and they make this film. So, it was made during in Argentina during the Onganía dictatorship, which was established after a right-wing coup in 1966. And this dictatorship is part of a kind of continent-wide pro-capitalist counter-revolution. And it's one of many authoritarian bureaucratic states that would take power across Latin America starting in the 50s. And in this, the context in which they're making it, again, this is a regime that favors foreign capital, produces terrible conditions for workers, prohibits strikes, has wage freezes, also that explicitly treated universities as potential centers of subversion. They had the military invade universities, attack students. There was also a large campaign against immoralism and certain kinds of gender, like how women could look or how men could look, things like this. But this also happened, so that's one context, which is also why this film was produced clandestinely and shown that way. It's also during the same context of major worker and student uprisings, particularly in Argentina where it's produced. This is in 1969, is a super crucial year for these uprisings, which are workers, students, and students and workers together, which really laid the ground for kind of the radicalization of the armed left. In Argentina, had a very large urban guerrilla. The larger kind of continental, context for this is the anti-neocolonial or anti-imperial revolutionary politics in Latin America at this time. So this is really, part of the kind of generation, a revolutionary generation whose intellectual context is a revolutionary politics that is explicitly anti-imperialist. I think the kind of important, major important events for forming this generation are one, U.S.-backed overthrow of the democratically elected government in Guatemala in 54, I believe, or 56? 54. And the Cuban Revolution. And these are, I just want to emphasize this because you can see, so much of this film is about analyzing neocolonialism. And this analysis is really key to revolutionary politics across the continent at this time. Because this is really a time when, the U.S. is, the U.S. has been, since the 19th century, continually sending gunboats into Latin America. The military domination, imperialist military domination is really explicit. After basically 1930, there's more of a shift towards economic domination, where it's more U.S. elites exercising control through covert operations and through economic control. But after World War II, you really have Latin America again becomes a place where Washington is executing imperialist violence through its proxies. And I think we can, I'll just send the end later for that.
I mean, one of the reasons that I thought it would be interesting to do this is that, precisely picking up on this point, that it's often assumed that if you're talking about politics and art, then in some way you must be instrumentalizing the art and subjecting it to a politics instead of just allowing the art to exist in itself. And a lot of this is precisely because hegemonic politics has cornered the market on neutrality and invisibility. Mm-hmm. Right? It's not as if the politics aren't there, it's just that the politics are invisible because it's so hegemonic and dominant that nobody sees it. The other thing that happens, picking up on what you just said, is that there is a way in which then politics is often collapsed into the content of works of art, and formal analysis is just kind of given over to those who are going to pursue it for the ends of the kind of hegemonic political realm. And I think that one thing that is really fascinating about this film is that obviously it's not just, in French you'd say, c'est vraiment du cinéma, quoi. It's really cinema, in the sense that it uses the language of cinema to communicate as much as it uses words and sounds and whatnot. I mean, the sound montage is brilliant throughout. And so I thought that what I would do is I'll just play this, it's about a 4 or 5 minute sequence, and then comment on it. I think that it is, it gives us a great microscopic formal account of everything that we've just been saying, probably better than we've just said it. So with no further ado, I'll turn this on.
Es su dependencia. Dependencia económica, dependencia política, dependencia cultural. Primero España, después Inglaterra, hoy Estados Unidos. La historia de nuestros países es la historia de un interminable saqueo colonial. Sin independencia económica, no hay independencia política. José Martí decía, el pueblo que quiera ser libre, que lo sea primero en negocios. En la dependencia no hay ninguna forma posible de desarrollo. El aparente desarrollo de algunas ciudades puerto, como Buenos Aires, traduce solo la creciente expansión de las grandes potencias en el seno de nuestras economías. Ayer Mitre, Pellegrini, Pinedo, hoy Prebisch, Frigerio, Alzogaray. Préstamos, inversiones, empréstitos sirvieron siempre a una misma política de sometimiento. La presunta ayuda imperialista es una ayuda que siempre cuesta más al que la recibe que al que la da. Por cada dólar invertido en América Latina, el imperialismo se lleva 4. Oro y café, carne y petróleo, trigo y estaño, el trabajo de un pueblo convertido en mano de obra barata, construyeron la riqueza de las grandes potencias. Es esta explotación la causa del atraso, la miseria, la opresión, la que posibilita el financiamiento y el alto nivel de vida de las naciones desarrolladas. La que hizo nacer esa oscura palabra inventada por el imperialismo. Subdesarrollo.
Thank you.
pretty incredible sequence. I'll just say a few things about it and then we'll kind of open up for a conversation and comment. The first is that formally the way in which it's constructed is, of course, from the very first part of the sequence that I showed you. Apart from two very minor kind of jump cuts, what you have is a circumambulatory pan that shows you 360 degrees of the city of Buenos Aires from above, as if you're from the zero point of visibility and you capture all things. In many ways, the point of view that you have is the point of view of ideology, which is that everything is seeable and understandable, and you have a 360-degree apprehension of everything that is there. What this reveals, I think, in relationship to this, and it makes me think of the great statement that was the basis for his film in the early 60s by Chris Marker. It's based on a Zen proverb. He made a film called The Sixth Side of the Pentagon, which is about the anti-war protests. And the Zen proverb is, if the five sides of the Pentagon are impregnable, and the Pentagon here is understood, he takes this end proverb to relate it to the real Pentagon in the United States. If the five sides of the Pentagon are impregnable, attack the sixth side. Which is, from one point of view, absolutely impossible, right? Because the Pentagon only has five sides. But then, when you actually think about it, that is a restricted aesthetic understanding of what a Pentagon is, because a building also has a basement and a top. So it at least has two other sides that you could potentially attack. And what you see here in the film is actually the zero point of visibility of ideology. If you imagine where that camera was positioned as it was making its circumambulatory pan around the city, is precisely the point of view at which the film attacks, because the next image, coded with the term of underdevelopment, right, which is, it's as if the zero point of visibility is what drops the dead or dying cattle into this underground slaughterhouse that then emerges, because we've gone into the underworld of production, of course, that sustains the entire system that we've just overseen. And in doing that, then, I think one of the things that's orchestrated is you have a kind of first aesthetic revolution where you go from the world of luxury and domination and its colonial endeavors to the underworld that are the workers that have actually produced it. But if, as you watch the sequence, of course, there's the montage with the juxtaposition with the American-style 50s advertising that begins with the workers. But as you watch the sequence and it goes through the sequence, I think it does something quite remarkable, and that is that just as you think you might have understood that, oh, well, this is the workers juxtaposed to the ruling class who see the world from above and have this 360-degree view from their penthouse, there's actually a kind of it's like a Russian doll phenomenon where you're actually put inside of yet another point of view, and that is that of the cattle and the beasts of burden that are being slaughtered. Because at one level you would say that, well, it's the workers who are, you know, those who are being oppressed by capitalism, but little by little through the sequence, as they're striking the cattle over the head, you'll notice that the rhythm and the beat of them being struck over the head is like the rhythm and the beat of the advertising images that are striking us over the head as viewers. And so the people or the beings being struck over the head are not simply the cattle. It's that the workers have it twofold against them. They're at once, it's the labor of material work, but then their brains are being blunted by the advertising industry that's literally sledging them over the head. And then as the sequence transitions, the cattle begin to die, and the camera comes in closer, and there's one cattle in particular that you see its eye open, and as it's beginning to fade and die, the images of the advertising actually come to life, and they become moving images, right? So the transition is one of the more the one, meaning all of the beasts of burden, if they be human or non-human, if you want to use those distinctions, are transitioning into death, just as more the rest are transitioning into life, and that these are two self-reinforcing processes. There's a lot more that you could say about this sequence because it's very detailed. The sound montage is brilliant as well they do this extremely well throughout. There's this kind of disconnect between the diegetic sound that you would imagine emerging from a slaughterhouse versus a soundtrack that is creating this kind of more romanticized or distant vision of it that correlates to a large extent with the images that we see flashed on the 1950s kind of advertising campaign. And so I think that in microcosm, what we have here, if you're susceptible to it and open to it, is the possibility of being led through the looking glass, so to speak, and having the power of aesthetics to communicate something at the level of the sensorium. It's not spelling out the argument and saying, you know, this is what's going on here, but it's actually constructing a formal set of relations that are destabilizing and dismantling the dominant hegemonic aesthetics. But why don't we, we've been talking for a bit now because we're excited about this, so why don't we just open up if there are comments, questions, criticisms, concerns?
Thank you very much for the presentation. It's very close to my actual research. I have two comments. The first is that I think that what we have seen is not the zero point of ideology or the most material part. I think is the what is called by Marx in his German ideology the first material language. The first degree of interpretation. That is not argumentation, is not the ideological part, mm-hmm. is the first language in which we communicate the material. And I think that is my second comment, that is a choice that left-wing intellectualists have to do between realisms or naturalisms aesthetics. And this distinction comes from the early Marxism. We have the option of Engels that says that artists doesn't have to show directly the social contradiction is the work of art, as we assume that the director of this film has made. The position of Engels was that artist has to just do art, and the contradictions, social contradictions, is going to appear. And the other way was the Lenin, the option of Lenin, that said that we have to show, was the naturalist option. And we have the intermediate point, that is Lukács. And after we have the same two options in the first generation of critical theory, we have Adorno that made the choice of realism, that artists and music in this case doesn't have to show explicitly the material contradiction. And that is why he was always upset with Brecht, because Brecht said no, artists have to show, Brecht will be okay with this interpretation and this film. And we have Benjamin. That was in my reading the intermediate too, because for Benjamin it's necessary the material change of the art, that is we can see in the art in the reproductive times, but it was also necessary the genius of that the genius of the artist was free for him. So he's an intermediate, I guess. And right now we have the same opposition, Rancière, Badiou. And maybe the intermediate or the middle position is Wartenberg, maybe the critical cinema of Wartenberg. And for me, it's like three are correct, but if intellectuals have to make a choice, and I could see that in Peru, my intellectual friends of the left that are rich thinks that we can change the world with films and doing critics of films, and my other friends that are like activist leftians from the public university call them radical chics, or le chic radicalism. I'm not in this group because I'm poor for them. And the others, the leftian from the public universities, are seen by the others as Leftian primitivism, or primitive Leftian, that doesn't have the profound eye to see how art could change things. And I think that is a kind of difficult position that we have to make as intellectuals, and implies a big responsibility. I haven't made my options, but that I think that I'm doing in my thesis, aesthetical social theory, and I think that we have to be aware of the critique that came from the critique of the aesthetical turn of political or social thought. Because right now we see, like in every big school of political and social thought, that we think that aesthetics is the material, like in research thought, and we can change things. But I think we have to hear to these critics that came from the other part that said, no, you can't change things like that. You have to see that like not more materialistic way, but in a kind of language already mediated in a political way.
Mm-hmm. You want to say something?
Well, I completely relate to the way you're talking about the way these things tend to pan out. I think that, but for me, there's always this tricky thing that happens in, you know, saying, well, we can't change anything, so this is the kind of Adorno position of people who, you know, grab onto that, so we should just keep, you know, doing our criticism of bourgeois art forms and just keep doing what we were always doing. And, like, the kind of, I mean, that line of thinking that basically, I find that very, let me just take a step back there, because that often means saying, well, we just accept that art are these bourgeois forms that we've been told are art, like fine art, literature, music, and kind of accept the institutionalized forms in which they're given to us. That, I mean, this is, I think, like one very kind of typical way this pans itself, it plays out. And therefore, there's a kind of like intellectual exercises that we can do that mean that stay kind of contained within those forms of practice that have already been institutionalized, which I think is very different from the argument that you might have to totally rethink what an aesthetic practice might be, which is something that I do think that the kind of line coming from Brecht does, and I don't think that Adorno is offering. But I also think that, you know, this, that the way that it tends to get divided up, like, well, aesthetics is going to do everything, and, you know, material practice and writing, that's, I think, a kind of crazy division, even though it always reproduces itself. Like, of course, ideology is also material, and of course, ideology is central to thinking about social transformation. And I mean, I understand aesthetics as very much like related to kind of like profound concept of ideology. So to me, to kind of try to divide those and to say, well, you just choose one or the other, it doesn't make a lot of sense from the perspective of thinking of social transformation. What that might mean then, you know, for, I think that the way, like you said, what people are, who are rich and people who are not might take different positions in these, because we also have to be realistic about, you know, when we have to sell our labor power and do so in institutions that we didn't make that are set up to neutralize the political capacities that our cultural production could have. That, I think, is a real, does like produce all kinds of contradictions, you know, for people to make those decisions, but we have to be, you know, realistic about the fact that the ways that aesthetic practices have been institutionalized in ways precisely to make them useful for producing dominant culture, right? And to kind of hem in other possibilities.
I know Pierre wants to jump in on this. Just very quickly, I would say that you touched on a lot of different authors and movements and whatnot, so it would be impossible to go through all of them. But I do think that the broad debates in the 20th century, and you know, written on this in detail, so this isn't just an off-the-cuff comment, that there's a tendency to identify particular positions as being those that are the most amenable to the correct political stance. This can be realism in the case of Lukács, the later Lukács, not the early Lukács. This can be a certain understanding, a very specific understanding of the autonomy of art within Adorno. This can be what Marcuse calls the aesthetic dimension, etc. That most thinkers who have intervened in these debates tend to have their privileged bridge between aesthetics and politics, and usually they foreclose other bridges, right? So that the avant-garde, for instance, for Lukács is not a bridge towards good politics. I think that that approach tends to do two things. One is reify the very opposition between art and politics instead of beginning the other way around, which is what I was suggesting earlier, that we should understand that aesthetic practices are always already political. And the second thing that it does is it suffers from a kind of blueprint model of theoretical work in which the role of the intellectual is to come up with the correct blueprint for how every other cultural producer should function. And I think that that hasn't played out well politically, aesthetically, culturally, and is in many ways, it's an impossible project. And here we come back to someone like Brecht or others for that matter who have a much more situated and anchored understanding of aesthetic practice. Brecht, one of the reasons that he was so brilliant in his conceptualization of epic theater is that he said that epic theater should not be a model. Epic theater is a mode of doing theater within a very specific conjuncture, and it should never become the absolute exemplar of great theater because all theater is situated. All theater wears itself out, has to be reinvented, etc. And so I think the situatedness of it makes it such that you can't simply have a blueprint from the outside. Mm-hmm. But Pierre, you wanted to jump in on this, I think, right?
Yeah. So first of all, I agree with your general picture of aesthetics and the notion of aesthetic revolution, but what I disagree with is, in some sense, the pertinence of the example to think aesthetic revolution, mainly because I want to historicize it a bit.
This yeah. example? Yeah.
Yeah. Not that it's not in itself a very avant-gardistic mode of production and a very, very intelligent and interesting film, but the way I see it in its historical conjuncture is more as a form of counter-propaganda in a dictatorial and hegemonic setting that in some sense forecloses a certain epistemic quality of art. Not that we don't need propaganda or anything. I'm not saying this in a sort of normative injunction, but I'm saying that the epistemic status of the work in some sense is a different one in that conjuncture, and certainly a necessary one in that conjuncture. But to think aesthetic revolution today, we need to consider, well, a very, very changed historical ontology of art. We need to consider very changed conditions of production of art. We need to consider forms of domination in the Western world, which are much more veiled and much more or less blatantly autocratic, although they are becoming more and more autocratic. So in some sense, the problem is that if we take this film as the example outside of this historical context for an aesthetic revolution, we risk losing any possibility of distinction between art, propaganda, and popular culture. And the problem is, in my opinion, an epistemic one, because in some sense, I would see that the historical ontology of art in the Western world since the 1960s, or we might even go to the 20s with Brecht, has allowed for a certain epistemic quality to artworks imminently that has something, I think, to offer, and that is worth thinking through. Whereas, if we abandon the distinction in some sense, we risk losing abandoning the epistemic qualities.
Distinction between
art, propaganda, and popular culture. Because if we follow the text, in many ways, we have a blatant propaganda from the Argentinian dictatorship, right? And what is needed is a counter-propaganda. And in some sense, there's no way to really distinguish between propaganda and art within the text, and I don't disagree with the statement in the text in that specific historical conjuncture, but the way art arose, at least in the historical ontology that we have from Brecht and Benjamin onwards, is in some sense a different one. that sort of values a certain specificity, not that I'm tied to any specific notion of form, but rather, I mean, if we say Brecht was doing epic theater, it was still in some sense theater, so there was a certain preservation of the epistemic quality, and we can see that art in some sense disappeared under fascism to become, if at all, counter-propaganda, a necessary one. So I want to preserve, in some sense, a certain epistemic quality of art that we risk losing if we take this example out of its context. And
what is that epistemic quality of art that you're interested in preserving?
Well, so in many ways, I would say the fact that art produces a certain illusion of autonomy. So this is obviously coming from an Adornian reading. Not that Adorno didn't make many mistakes in his aesthetics, but I do think that in this illusion of autonomy lies a certain, in some sense, possibility, because art is sealed off in certain ways. Art operates in a series through a series of translations, right? And it in some sense produces the illusion of an autonomy. It's never autonomous, and it's always already political, but nevertheless, there's something that is at work if we enter, in some sense, in this illusion. And I would say that the production of this illusion has always a specific genealogy that we need to think through. And I would say that the sort of sealed-off character of art at a certain historical conjuncture allows for a certain epistemic quality in it because of the translations it operates.
I would just say a few things. One is that, just as a proviso, of course, we're not saying that this film is the example of aesthetic revolution. I think that instead, it's a way of dropping a pin on something and saying, let's look at this because it's quite interesting within its conjuncture. The second thing that I'd say is that the understanding of aesthetics that we're trying to develop is one within which the very distinctions between something like art and non-art, or art, propaganda, and popular culture would be operative. And we fully recognize that within the hegemonic aesthetics, in this broad sense, those distinctions are important for very specific reasons, while at the same time, we don't want to maintain them or reify them in important ways. And that's also for, I would say, additional philosophic reasons, and that is that there is, at least from my vantage point, we haven't talked about this, but from my vantage point, there is no essence of art. There is no there's not some special magic about art, other than what social communities have believed to have you know, projected into or have constituted as a value or a spirit of works of art. So in that sense, it is a cultural signifier that changes with time and has certainly not always existed. The modern concept of art is really the result of a whole series of institutional and conceptual forces at the end of the 18th, early 19th century, and it's been extremely well documented. So in that regard, I wouldn't see the need to maintain this distinction. And the other thing that I would add to this is that it's almost always the case that when art becomes radically politicized, as in this case, that people then accuse it of losing its status as art. Rancière has made this argument very clearly in Emancipated Spectator, that when Santiago Sierra or other artists who do work with indigent lumpen proletariat community, or you know, destitute, I should say, lumpen proletariat communities, that at some point it risks just being politics and just losing its status as art. Arthur Danto has made a similar argument, but in a different vein and whatnot, and I categorically disagree with this, because the whole problem is that art is defined in terms of the hegemonic categories of what art is, meaning something identifiable within the dominant aesthetic matrix. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if you want to add.
No, I mean, I agree with that. I think often the kind of degradation of art because it's, you know, explicitly politicized, and then, you know, calling that, say that's not art, the same thing happens with literature, I think it functions really to police the kind of boundaries of what is going to be considered institutionalized, canonized. I mean, this has been this, it's like the, I mean, there's, I mean, you see this even with genres of like literature, like testimonial literature, right? Which basically, people didn't kind of want to count it as being literature. And this is literature that basically made it possible for working class and non-literate people to enter into the institution of literature. And there were enormous debates about was it really literature or not. should it kind of be considered in this way? So, I mean, for me, the question is always not, well, can we discern some kind of transcendent qualities of propaganda versus art? I think the more interesting question is always when those divisions come into play to try to say that something should not be considered as art or it's a lesser form of cultural production because it's propaganda, what are the political questions that are at stake in making that distinction? To me, that's really the question, because I agree with you, I don't think there's any kind of essence to art or to propaganda. I think an enormous amount of cultural production that we consume, that we, you know, is considered, you know, very artistic, could also be considered propagandistic, depending on, you know, how you're defining those terms.
Pierre and John, did you want to speak to this
point?
Yeah.
So I agree with everything you've said in this regard, but I disagree on the way to go through, because for me, in many ways, it's much more about working through the given forms to bring about the new. So in a way, I'm saying we cannot, in some sense, come to terms with any aesthetic revolution if we don't work through the images that we have. And I'm sure that we need to be weary of the distinctions being made. And what I'm arguing for is, in some sense, art as a critical category, that we grant a certain object or a certain installation, whatever it is, a certain epistemic quality that allows us to, in some sense, think things like the epistemic revolution. So in this regard, I must say that maybe 90% of what art is in museums needn't be art, or is just bad art, or needn't be categorized as art. So I'm in some sense arguing that I would like to preserve a certain epistemic category as epistemic critical category of art, without wanting to inscribe myself in a sort of modernist legacy that is all but anything, if anything, problematic. So the point of an aesthetic revolution would in many ways be to not, in some sense, reject the forms outright, because we cannot do that. That's my claim. We can't reject the given forms in which art has come to be. Rather, if we want to come to terms with their destruction, then if we want to sort of move forward to something else, then we need to work through them. And how can we do that? Only if we appropriate them and then rework them from within, not necessarily meaning we can't enter from without, but I'm saying that if we don't seize them in their particularity, if we outright negate them and presuppose the lack of separation. So I'm sort of arguing for working through.
I know that was kind of more of a comment, right, than a question, so I can go on. John, did you want to jump in this?
Well, my question is related actually to something, Jennifer, you just said. You know, part of what it seems to me that you all are doing is you're concerned with the way that knowledge is produced in the university around aesthetics. Mm-hmm. I hear you all saying this. And so my question is, how do you understand your relationship to orthodox aesthetics as you all have characterized it? I'm interested in that for a number of reasons, but you know, when you say you're doing another aesthetics, mm-hmm. part of the danger, it seems to me, is that the sort of mainstream aesthetics industry can say back to you, that's nice, but that's not what we do. Mm-hmm. You're doing something different. Mm-hmm. You even said so yourself. And part of the danger is that orthodox discourse isn't just a discourse, of course, it's a whole industry. They have their jobs, they have their textbooks, they have their conferences, they have their journals. Part of the question I always have, and what makes your work so interesting to me, is how do you do something different, but then at the same time you have access to that stuff? Mm-hmm.
Right, which is kind of similar.
Right. Right. And so my question for you all is, in your own work, mm-hmm. with this project, in a word, really, like, how's it going? You know? are they listening to you? Can you get orthodox? Can you get people who work in orthodox aesthetics to hear this, or do they say, "Well, you're working in politics," and then political theorists say, "Well, why are you watching these movies? We're talking about Ross."
Yeah.
you know what I'm saying?
All too well.
Right? And so, my question just simply is, do you want them to hear you? Do you want their resources? Does this kind of aesthetics get done in the academy, or do you see it happening someplace else?
Yeah.
Could you maybe just talk about your strategy for that? I'm obsessed with it.
That's a really good question. I mean, I think this is something we were talking about the other day, I started thinking about it in relationship to the cultural producers I write about, the book that I'm finishing is about leftist artists and art collectives and particular relationship between like cultural producers and anti-systemic movements. And I thought, talked to lots of people from various generations who are really committed to that kind of practice, and I think that how they do it is a kind of like this double agent thing, right? Because most people, everybody who I've written about and whose work I admire has to get money in some way. They're not independently wealthy, and so that either means in practice like somehow having some engagement with the cultural industries, and then usually it means having another side practice. So you'd have your street art, and then you get grants to do a museum exhibition once a year and live off of that somehow. Or some people just have a kind of day job, and that they're teachers or work in certain retail or whatever, and then do their work that they don't have to then deal with the compromises that entails doing kind of institutionalized art practice. And I think that is, and then they also figure out how to get resources from these institutions and filter them to the communities that they're working with. And I think that's, there's an enormous amount of creativity that goes into figuring out how to do that, given, when you do have to sell your labor and you have to work with these institutions that want boutique products. That's what they want. I think this question is even is a really important one given the professionalization and institutionalization of certain kinds of political art under the aegis of social art. I actually think that figuring out how to do that is part of a creative practice, right? That's as much like how are you going to live? How are you going to pay for the food that you have to eat while you're doing your street art or whatever? These are the Vishit Hiro Solana say as much that they. So, in my own case, I think that, I'm a university professor. I definitely, I publish in academic journals, etc. So, I definitely have a foot in that world. I mean, very much, that's my kind of bread and butter. My own work, what I try to do, I think, is really amplify and think about and take seriously and try to support these practices that oftentimes don't have as much of an institutional support that I do, and teach them and write about them and give them visibility, if that helps to.
Yeah.
I might just say methodologically that for me it's been important to distinguish between, and it's a heuristic distinction, but it might also pick up on Pierre's comments and questions, the difference between an interpretation and an intervention. And an interpretation is a mode of theoretical practice that operates within the extant system of coordinates. And so if you're trained in philosophy today and you want to get a job in social and political philosophy, you should write your PhD on John Rawls at Harvard and pursue that accordingly. That type of theoretical practice then is one that is well oiled by the machinery that we have, and it's what we're all encouraged to do. An intervention is an attempt to not simply play by the rules of a well-established social game, because that's all that it really is when you think about it, but instead it's an attempt to intervene at the level of the very rules of the game. Mm-hmm. And so what that does mean is that you don't simply play the game as you're supposed to within a particular discipline, within particular cliques, within particular cultural settings, universities, etc. But in order to intervene successfully, I think that you have to have sites of leverage. And an intervention of the kind of mightier than thou, I am unsullied by any institution whatsoever, and am completely outside of everything, ultimately means you might run into, I think, some of the problems that Pierre's highlighting, and that is that, well, then you have absolutely no traction. And so I think one of the major conundrums is how you can intervene within the extant systems in order to gain traction, because intervening in is always taking seriously the given situation, how it operates. And so in many ways, my own work as well at a practical and methodological level is precisely an attempt to intervene. And intervene has not come from absolute outside. There is none, as far as I'm concerned. I think that's a kind of anthropological myth of the 19th century, that there's this pure outside that one could somehow get to. And so then that, of course, at least for me, gives methodological framing. Then a whole series of other questions come, like how exactly you do that, what are the concrete nuts and bolts, which I'd love to talk about as well. But that's how I understand it.
I mean, one thing I would just add to this, just speaking from my own experience in terms of how to do that, for me, it is also meant being pretty open-minded about where disciplinarily where my work might end up, because it's not, I mean, I don't expect it to have a lot of resonance in art history, for example, because of how that discipline works. But, you know, I've just found, in a very practical sense, communities of interlocutors across a lot of different disciplines, and that would not necessarily be the place where you think necessarily art is going to be studied.
And a lot of them outside of the academy.
And a lot outside of the academy.
The intellectual production and cultural production that's done outside of the academy is, of course, not only enormous, but some of the most fascinating and powerful intellectual and cultural production of the contemporary era. If you look at, we were just talking about this the other day, but if you look at the 20th century and you want to highlight the titans of American philosophic thought of the 20th century, most of those people were part of the Black radical tradition and completely outside of the academy in various ways. And so I think it's also important not just to have the academy or other institutions become the sole sites of intervention, because we have to recognize them for what they are and the limits of intervention within those particular interstices. But I know there were other questions, comments, Luz, and then Monsieur aussi, si vous voulez.
I wanted to tell you about the epistemic concern, that there's two epistemological criticisms that are concretist in the European continental tradition, but also Miranda Fricker, that they are situated after the Celarsian revolution, and Brentano revolution in European thought. That I think Miranda Fricker, she does it in an implicit way, but completely make the relationship in art specifically. So I think that he has already made a little of this work. And I think that it's important, the regard about the epistemic concern of art, but also ontology.
Are there other questions, comments, Ravel, is that a hand? No, it's a tentative one?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe.
Okay.
I think, like, I was thinking something that you were saying, Jennifer, and I can just also go back to your question. It's about, the question is whether you would want such film to be recognized as art and what that means. Like, so you were talking about testimonial, for example, mm-hmm. And how it starts off as this really radical force, right? Like, and then the academy recognizes it as a valid option to study what happens with them. Mm-hmm. So then how do you prevent, like, absorbing this sort of narrative within a very, very established narrative of avant-gardeness, for example? Mm-hmm. So do you also have to look at, like, where it's recirculating or, like, something like that?
No, I think that's, a good question, but I think that you can't prevent something from being, we can't control the way that things are, the reception, right? So the idea that we could, you know, if things were not recognized as art, they wouldn't be, you know, commodified or picked up. Like, I don't think that that's possible. And I'm often, I think what, you know, what you're speaking to, the way that forms that in one context might be, you know, radical, but then they become institutionalized in ways that really defang them, and that's something that we know happens with all kinds of forms of cultural production. But I also don't think that's a once and for all process. Do you know what I mean? Like, the kind of social life of art is very complex, and that, the, you know, something like this is a canonical film, basically. So there's obscure cinema, avant-garde cinema, Latin American cinema, mm-hmm. this is like part of the canon. And I don't think that, you know, and so that certainly could lead itself to totally depoliticize readings. Even you could read this film just in terms of its kind of use of montage and take out of the rubber. I mean, people do that. And not necessarily this film, but in general, but that doesn't mean that that once and for all neutralizes its, you know, its meaning. I think that when we think of when something gets recognized and institutionalized, like something like Testimonio, or then, you know, there's also really important kind of material questions and questions of dissemination that go with it. So I would not want to say, well, I would want something to be protected from its kind of potential neutralization if that meant, you know, it wouldn't get read as much, that there wouldn't be kind of resources given towards the people who produce it. Like, those, I think, are kind of the questions to think about when we talk about the kind of nuts and bolts of what that might mean without there being, you know, this kind of bogeyman that if something enters into an institution, it's therefore necessarily going to be defanged, because it can have, art and culture has a very long life that can enter into an institution and at the same time, you know, have enormous political impact depending on how it's being received in that context or in other ones.
There's also, just on this point, there's a really, I think, historically inappropriate account of avant-garde work in some generic sense of the term, where it is extra institutional or something like that, and then it gets recuperated as soon as you see you know, one of the ready-mades in a museum, and all of a sudden it loses all of its power. What that does is it gives all of the agency to the institutions, and in particular the art institution, and it doesn't recognize the fact that, for instance, for a ready-made to happen, what you need is the agency of an artist intervening within an institution. And so you can't have a ready-made without an institution. That's Duchamp's whole point.
Yeah.
And so I think there's often very poorly understood peddlings of an idea of what avant-garde production would be, or the history of the avant-garde, for that matter. One of the other things that the avant-garde has done historically is to produce institutions. And there's a whole series of counter-institutions that they mobilize. Bauhaus is probably the single most significant one, and it speaks volumes on the theoretical traditions that many of us have inherited, at least, that, you know, someone like Peter Berger in his famous theory of the avant-garde doesn't really talk about Bauhaus. And the reason for that is also because it's not producing fine art. You know, it's producing art for the masses and design and whatnot. So anyway, this opens up other things. But I know, Alejandra, you wanted to jump in.
I just had a quick comment, and this comment might be very much rooted in the fact that I have never formally studied aesthetics as such, but I've been thinking of things like graffiti, and even things that are cultural products that are very wide circulation, such as, you know, things like cat videos or things that are circulated on YouTube and on Twitter and memes, and so things that are truly circulated online. And I was wondering if it might be true that these types of things are considered so vulgar, right, or so unworthy of, I don't know, thorough and academic cultural consideration, that it might be. So I'm thinking of the vulgarity of all of these things that are cultural production, I do think, that are mass circulation, and that are not, I wonder if these kinds of academic frameworks even begin to consider that work, right, as existing completely outside of any institution, including the way you think about aesthetics, and if that has any implications to any implications for the applicability of thinking about an aesthetic revolution. So that is, we might not even, I guess the comment I'm trying to make in a nutshell is that we might not even be able to theorize the aesthetic revolution because it is going to occur with such marginality or in such a marginalized space that no one is even going to come up with theoretical frameworks to understand it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, what you're getting at, like the way that the cultural production is divided into these categories, like it's mass culture, popular culture, high culture, and then we have, and these are, you know, slotted into the different disciplinary frameworks people study them, right? So art history, art criticism studies, fine art, cultural, some kinds of versions of cultural studies will look at mass culture, and popular, you know, anthropology tends to look at popular culture. So there is this kind of division that happens. And then bringing different methodologies of analysis. So, and this is, I think, one of the reasons why we've been trying to think of aesthetics, you know, more broadly beyond this kind of division that, like, you, because I don't think we're arguing that an aesthetic revolution or, you know, what would be something that we would only learn about by looking at recognized cultural fine art. I think that just as, like you're saying, popular art or the kind of cultural production that exists within these other categories are just as vital and just as important for thinking about what aesthetics can do.
So I think Audrey and Pierre and Katie, okay, well, a bunch of people now. We'll start with, does anyone want to speak to this point that's on the table? No. Audrey, why don't you pick up a few and then we'll go.
So I'm asking this question from a point of view of deep skepticism of somebody who spent 5 years in the New York art world, including 2 years doing institutionalized socially engaged art, which is just a cover up for liberalism, and neoliberalism. So I've become very skeptical of the potential of art to lead to any kind of emancipation over the years, and I led that and moved to political science, actually. So my question then is, in your project or your model, what is the relationship between art and politics? Does it collapse? Is it two sides of the same coin? Are they two different kinds of practices? Or how does this work? Because my concern is that by expanding the definition of aesthetics to include such a broad or have such a broad understanding of aesthetics, we kind of dilute, maybe dilute the category, or things become muddled, or the two collapse. So yeah, I guess that's just the question.
I mean, take that. I mean, just because it directly relates to a lot of the work that I've done, the starting point for me is the conceptual refusal of the structural opposition between aesthetics and politics, because there is no, I don't think, either conceptual or material basis for it. That does not mean, though, that what you get is just a simple identification between the two. Instead, you have, in many ways, I mean, it's an aesthetico-epistemological shift in which instead of having substances with well-delimited borders to them, like art and politics, you have a very different understanding of these cultural signifiers as floating signifiers that have a certain inertia to them, so they have centers of gravity to them, but they vary over time, space, and social different social stratification. So there's no such thing as just art or just politics. Instead, they are, I not only would, but do refer to them as concepts in struggle. Right? Now, that doesn't mean that, and I'm not just ignoring the question or like muddling it, it doesn't mean then that there aren't centers of gravity to these things as they're used in a particular conjuncture. So we have an operative understanding of aesthetics that most people would admit at some level. And I'm fine with that. But what I think is important is that if you desubstantialize the categories, then you can look at the ways in which practices materially operate. And looking from a materialist point of view at how the art world in New York functions, it is not an easy task to say, well, this is the political and this is the artistic. On the contrary, there's a kind of intertwined set of matrices in which sometimes they're inextricable, sometimes there are slight differences between the two, if you want to use kind of operative concepts of them. And so what that means overall is an understanding of the ways in which even the common sense understanding of aesthetics is, in all of its different dimensions of how it's produced, circulated, and received, constantly intersecting in various ways with the common sense understanding of politics. And then what we need is a different cartography of those relations that's neither based on the substantialist understanding of an opposition, nor is it based on some type of conflation where it's always already the same thing, but instead a kind of striated topographic account of all of the different ways in which they interrelate. And then to actually answer the question, because I haven't at all yet, it's that if aesthetics wasn't so politically powerful, our dominators, our oppressors, wouldn't be using it so efficaciously all the time. And wouldn't be so invested in it. Because in many ways, when you want to understand how people are, you know, subjectivized, look at the culture industries. That's how they're formatted. For the high cultures that can also be going to art museums and feeling edified by seeing some socially engaged art that's actually divorced from the material conditions of oppression that have produced those who then produce the art for the gaze. And so there are different ways of doing this, but I think overall there is it's a very powerful way of forging subjects. And then the question becomes how you can produce counter-forges, right? And that is, I agree, extremely difficult, and the institutional apparatus that we inherited is not one that's conducive to it, and it's certainly not in Chelsea that you're going to find the majority of interesting things in that regard. Yeah.
I mean, I just want to add to that, that I think it's one of the kind the things you know, that is so frustrating about the discourse on social practice is because then you define basically engaged art as a genre of contemporary artistic production. Without recognizing that the whole apparatus of course, contemporary artistic production is completely subservient to the global art market and the kind of tastemakers of, and like you said, it's basically a cover for the field of liberalism. So I think that, and what it does encourages the kind of thinking that says, well, like, what can art do? Like, well, art's going to do these things or save these people or make, people provide social uplift, whatever. And that's, I think that's always the kind of wrong way to approach that question. Because I don't think art necessarily is going to do anything, just like artists are in no way going to necessarily be progressive forces, right? This is the kind of the thing I was talking about earlier, like why does it make sense to just think of intellectuals or cultural producers as a political collectivity? Because you can have all different kinds of class positions and politics within that. What I tend to think of in my own work is the kind of long tradition of leftist thought that has recognized that cultural transformation is an essential part of social transformation. And we talk about, I mean, there's from everybody from Mao to Che to Lenin to, black radicals to feminists that, people working in ecological politics all talk about this and have worked in that capacity. And you can think of understanding culture in as ideology, as the ways that we think of social relations, as kind of everything that can entail, and that anti-systemic movements have really profound cultural aspects to them. And that might entail the thing we recognize as cultural production. It might entail things like forms of popular culture that don't fit the categories of the kind of bourgeois definitions of art. But then I think, for me, the question is what kind of forms of aesthetic practice and cultural practices are part of these anti-systemic movements, and how are they participating in them, and whether or not they are or are always recognized as art. That's how I tend to kind of frame the question in a different way, because I don't think it makes sense to try to think of, is this kind of thing you're talking about, the talisman compass, to analyze something on its own, like a single work of art is going to, it doesn't, to me, make sense without thinking of how it can be embedded in cultures, be part of also fomenting and creating cultures of resistance. And I do think in that way, that's actually, and a lot of that work takes place outside of, I think, the art institutions.
See, there's a number of comments. It's about 8:15. Why don't we, a couple, two of them, is that cool if we do Leandro and Katie?
Could I go first?
Yeah, for sure.
Sorry, Leandro. Because I know we don't have time to do this, but I think it might be worth, just because I'm building on something, I was very lucky to have Leandro as my curatorial guide to the Louis Vuitton Institute when we went recently. So we've been thinking a lot about, I just sort of wanted to maybe open up with a little bit of a request, for something besides this interrogation thing, for maybe Leandro to talk a little bit about curation as something that is engaging with very materially with the ways that money moves and the ways that art gets presented and the sort of currently terrible exhibition right now at the Louis Vuitton Institute, which is infuriating for a number of reasons. But I also wanted to build on Audrey's point. And my question is kind of just a request for you to concretize, or maybe if you have a sort of thought about what you thought was the most interesting binary you were pushing on, which is the form and content separation, just in the ways that I see contemporary art spaces being, contemporary liberal art spaces being really interested in admitting political work as political content, with a presumption that this political content is already bad art. What I mean by that is, like, there's an exhibit on at the Jeu de Paume, which has kind of straightforward interviews with migrants projected on the walls, and qua art, I find them sort of difficult to engage with. I find the content interesting. I find the sort of, I'm interested and invested in the type of analysis and the type of information that is being presented. And I think that there's a way that that, as political content, is digestible and is kind of demanded by these sorts of liberal art institutions, and also by, like, liberal academies that are really interested in examining migrants as political objects, or in reading indigenous literatures. I find that academic space, that's the sort of, like, liberal, liberal academic spaces are really interested in producing and asking for political content without being interested in or expecting politicized form content structures. And I guess maybe this is also a little bit of what Pierre was asking for, but just, would like to see if maybe you all can sort of play with or grow something that is a little bit more contemporary, because I think the ways that art structures demand certain types of politicized form and content, and sort of presume an already failed form for that political content, that it's going to be sort of rudimentary, or it's going to be testimony, that creates its formal expectations.
I mean, that exhibition's a good example, because it speaks to the kind of the stories of these subaltern migrants and doesn't talk about the causes of why they're forced to migrate. And I think that's so you have the kind of that. And to me, I mean, that's very much kind of what I talked about before, like the critique that Solanas and Gentino make. And you can have this, these heart-wrenching stories, which is absolutely true of that exhibition, but there's no kind of indictment, like, it doesn't teach us anything about what produced that condition. And to me, that is, I think part of what you're saying is, yes, there's enormous kind of cachet that institutions have by incorporating the stories of global subalterns in whatever form that might take, and that's demanded in the kind of institutionalization of certain forms of kind of liberal multiculturalism in the academy and art institutions, and it is also a form in some cases of widening kind of audience base. It's of producing kind of veneer of progressivism that doesn't necessarily have to rethink the kind of social function of those institutions and their position, their relationship to power, right? I think that's
I want to hear Liana as well on the curatorial aspects. Do you want to jump in now, or you have another?
I'm sorry to put you on the spot, but
no, I don't know if I have something to say about it. What I'm interested in, and I think it relates to what you were both saying right now, is actually thinking about the audiences, right? So that is, in a way, I think it relates to what Pierre was saying as well. So to me also what lacks, or the problem in this institution, in the Jeu de Paume exhibition, for example, is just the fact that the audience that is already going there doesn't need to be informed in these ways, just is receiving the same information coming from the same media, and so I don't think it really contributes in any way, and in that sense, I find it very institutionalized and lacking, and we were discussing these sort of tools to reveal something and to engage in a way that we're not. And which to me, and I wanted to ask you, and this is what's my question for you actually, how do you think about the relationship between the makers and reception, in the sense of what makes me really uncomfortable about this movie when I saw it again today, is the fact that I actually disagree that it's a counter propaganda of the dictatorship, because it doesn't talk about the dictatorship at all, and it has very interesting elements which is drawing from the montage tradition of Eisenstein actually and Godard, and it is very produced actually for to me a middle class subject, but it's the one that is criticizing a lot in its aesthetic tools. I think that actually, and what makes me uncomfortable is the movie's from 68, right? And then Aung San Suu Kyi's dictatorship ends, and we have another dictatorship at the end of the 70s, right? That left 30,000 disappeared. Many of them, a large majority of them, coming from universities, were from lower middle class up, even upper class kids that were revolting against their parents, if you want to, and universities that are very criticized there, like the University of Buenos Aires, produced many of these revolutionary subjects, and I studied in that university this movie, and we still discuss it, and it still makes us think in certain ways, or act in certain ways. So I think that he actually does not talk to the class at very many, in a very Manichaean form, Manichaean in English, is conceiving as a good, or, you know, literally occupying the position of the good, which is a working class in that sense. Mm-hmm. And I find that to be very problematic, even, you know, at the end when they're talking about criticizing avant-garde art and sort of for it being like internationalized or to respond to neoliberal, neocolonial interests in the country, and they criticized the Institute d'Itela. And one of the artists there, or really related to that, was Jacobi. And I was thinking of him at the end of the movie when it ends with this image of Jacobi intervened in a magazine that was really popular magazine with a poster that said, "A guerrilla man doesn't die to be hung on a wall." So it's a poster that you would hang on your wall, but it said that, a very simple contradiction, a very easy political statement at the same time, to me, very interesting in how it intervenes media directly and in the way it's distributed. And I think it's more engaging for a different audience than this film that references dance of, you know, who in the working class in Argentina cares about Mujica Lainez? No one. And he spends like 10 minutes criticizing Mujica Lainez. And sort of those kind of strategies and rhetorics are sort of uncomfortable for me in this movie. And I wanted to ask you about what you think.
I'm not sure I'm convinced that you can presume that this is not, couldn't have a working class audience. I mean, like, I think the question would then come to, you know, exactly how it was disseminated, and from what I understand, at least what they've written about it, that you know, there was certainly with like militant groups and students and different, but I guess I think like the idea that a certain kind of formal language necessarily like closes out a working class audience, I just don't buy that. Like I think that like even when you think of mass culture, like it deploys really sophisticated formal, you know, strategies to interpolate us as consumers. And so the idea that something that's formally experimental is therefore, you know, not for the masses, I haven't found a kind of like convincing argument about that.
But my thing is not about the, I mean, I understand that and complicated. It's not about it being formal, it's not about it being experimental, actually. I mean, that's why I find it attractive.
Yeah.
It's just even the themes, that's what I'm saying, Mujica Lainez, you know, like, it was produced in a different moment, and I think that the struggle with social stratification has really changed, actually, I could totally imagine that being displayed in the 60s in a union in Argentina. Mm-hmm. Now I cannot imagine that, simply because, especially after the dictatorship that killed the anarchist and communist and socialist traditions in those unions. But I'm really thinking about his position, like Solanas himself is coming from a white middle class, probably from Buenos Aires, maybe, I'm assuming, I really don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm very broadly, so I'm thinking about that positionality, you know, just, I don't think he's coming from a very particular setting. I was thinking about the artistic tradition from which he's drawing, that is very European. I mean, I talk about Eisenstein and Godard, and they are even putting events, and so, that to me is, I don't know if it undermines the critique, but to me makes it problematic when he's saying that we are importing these cultural forms, that actually they're drawing from it very heavily.
Mm-hmm.
And then becomes to me problematic to thing they're addressing very directly.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, I think part of what one of the things you're, what if I'm following you, is saying, you know, like the question is, yeah, the film has a critique of the neocolonial intellectual in terms of intellectuals who instrumentalize to naturalize neocolonial domination, right? But of course, the condition of Latin American intellectuals is objectively a condition, right? So you were given, you know, your language is a colonial language, your, you know, institutions are dominated by colonial culture. So there's also, this is not just a kind of thing that one can choose and say, well, I'm going to divorce myself from all the European heritage of knowledge production and culture. You know, that I don't think that, like, I mean, of course, you have, like, greater or lesser kind of absorption by European culture or interest in indigenous cultural forms, but I don't think that we have to necessarily think of that, like, moralize it in that way. But to me, his question is, like, the way that Justino and Solanas and other people who I think have dealt with that conundrum is not to say that you have to divorce yourself from all of those things or disavow Warren's actual class position, but it's a question of what you do with the resources and capacities and language that you have and the languages that you have to work in, you know what I mean? So, and I think, yeah, certainly he's working, I think, they are working very effectively with, like, you know, artistic languages of European avant-garde. But it's like what you do with that. Do you know, I mean, I think that this is, I don't think that the form or, like, that's a question that any kind of subject in the colonial and neocolonial context has to deal with. There is no kind of possibility of a position of purity. I also think, you know, the question of, it seems you were saying that him being a kind of middle class intellectual himself is part of what made you suspicious about the production, was that that?
I'm just trying to think about him not recognizing that, or the fact that his family has a very Manichean position and he's addressing directly working class, not coming from there, and using these other, you know, even I disagree with the way I think that the indigenous peoples in this movie are being instrumentalized in a way that also, it's an outcome from a nationalist leftist person I disagree
mm-hmm.
with. The fact that he presents Buenos Aires as a white space, not recognizing that actually it's not. You know,
mm-hmm.
so I find it very problematic in many senses, and I think that comes from his position as a middle class man with a very specific tradition. And I find that complex in this movie in terms of his relation to who he very specifically in how it's rhetorically constructed wants to act.
Yes. Well, I think you could say it's a kind of anti-neocolonial or anti-imperialist film. It's not an anti-colonial film, for sure. You know, it's not. Like, there's an aspect of understanding that there is a colonialism upon which U.S. imperialism has been built. But I agree with you. Like, there's a kind of miserablest representation of indigenous people to a certain degree.
I want to pick up on, it's the conversation for the last kind of three comments about the way in which politics operates as a cultural signifier within the art world, and it operates, I think, in very specific ways. I thought it was fascinating how you sketched it out, that often it's the content that is inserted within liberal art spaces that themselves provide the form, at least insofar as they're the kind of mise-en-scène that presents it. And then the point is that this is political art, while at the same time it often communicates, depending on the particular show, I would agree with you in general with the show Je ne Pomme, what it communicates is that somehow it's lesser art, right? And so that if you're politicized, then you're making bad art. The other thing I think that it does, though, because there's a lot of different ways in which this operates, is often, and this overlaps with, I think, some of your concerns as well, is that the lens of analysis is that of a moralizing, individualizing, anti-systemic perspective. What you're supposed to do is perceive the plight of others who are deracinated from the system that has produced them as subalterns, others, etc. You're supposed to morally react to that, and usually affectively react to that, in a kind of lachrymose way, in which you wring your hands about, oh, these poor immigrants, if we could just have saved Paul, you know, or whoever the starving child was. And it then completely disconnects all of that, not only from the causes, but of course from the possibility of overthrowing the system that's produced that in the first place. And so if you had an exhibit on immigration, where at the end of it, there was, for instance, a Lord of, you know, a list of the Board of Trustees or the board of the museum and a list of their investments in the various companies and war machines that perpetuate the immigration, then you'd actually have something interesting to go on. Or if the entire exhibit was structured around the idea that it's not the whole narrative of immigration, immigration politics as it's often displayed within the liberal art institution, I'm thinking in particular of an exhibit, the artist's name I don't remember, that we saw in Chelsea, is that the best thing that could happen is for this poor soul to get to the Western world and find a good job. The best thing that could happen is not that Western imperial powers would stop their war endeavors in foreign countries for their own profit at the expense of decimating major swaths of the world population and perpetuating the immigration crisis. The immigration crisis has a source, it's Europe. Europe isn't the end or the goal of the immigration crisis, it's the source. And that would be a very different, and this, ultimately, the reason I wanted to highlight this is I think it's a really good example of what we're talking about as aesthetics in the larger sense of the term. And that politics can operate as a cultural signifier that's actually nested within a particular set of worldviews that constructs it in such a way that you feel like a good subject because of the way in which everything has been aesthetically orchestrated, while at the same time what's proposed is the possibility of transforming the system that's produced your affect as a hand-wringing liberal.
I mean, it's not, like, the best that can happen, it's not even that the person, you know, arrives and gets a job and does better, the best that can happen, or the goal of that kind of art practice is just for the person to be seen.
Yeah.
I mean, I spent like years, you know, selling projects that were about raising awareness and making
mm-hmm.
visible.
Yeah.
But it's making visible in this very one-sided way, of,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it's recognition, it's like
yeah.
Fanon, like it's paternalistic recognition that doesn't actually do anything to change
yeah.
The situation.
And it's based on the visibility fallacy that you simply made something visible and somehow you're going to change it. If that was the case, then poor people wouldn't be, 1,000 poor people a year, largely of color, wouldn't be being killed by the police, because we see it all the time. There's a ton of comments now. Maybe we should group them all together. If you want
this
to speak
like
to this. Perfect, perfect.
So this is basically John Berger's point in his essay in response to Susan Sontag's On Photography. And he's talking about suffering in like photojournalism, and in the news, photos and videos of suffering, is that it puts, and he says the best outcome of this, the best possible outcome in the way that the audience is interpolated by this, is that you go and like give some money to Oxfam, whatever, that's the best outcome, rather than, yeah, completely depoliticizes these positions, like these, and the wars that have created this suffering, and it turns people into images of universal suffering.
That's it.
And therefore the moral impetus is on us, and we feel bad in viewing it, and that's what leads it. But we don't see any way of changing it because we're not presented with the actual cause of the
mm-hmm.
suffering. So,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which text by John Berger are you thinking of?
I can't remember what it's called.
It's an essay though, it's not one of these.
It's an essay. It's in the like book that was published maybe 5 years ago of his like compiled
collected
writings on photography.
Yeah, no, that's a great reference.